We often look at our own solar system, and indeed other star systems, as very dry places, where liquid water is transient, and Earth is lucky to have it for as long as it has. But that ignores the most common occurrence of liquid water in the solar system, the ice shell moons. Few things are more interesting and mysterious than the liquid water oceans of Enceladus and Europa. These ice shell moons offer the possibility of life existing within these oceans, and there are many chances for this in the solar system. Also on the list for potential liquid water oceans are Ganymede, Callisto, Pluto, Titan, and a host of others. That's a lot of chances for life, and if life is present on one or more of these moons, they remain something that we can now only barely just detect hints of in other star systems, when in fact they may, hypothetically, be the most common abodes of life in the universe. And while exploring the oceans of the two best candidates in the solar system is on the agenda, it's going to be a while before we can do it. But there's one huge laboratory here on Earth that can shed clues on what it might be like in a European ocean. It's Earth's oceans, and they themselves remain mysterious, largely unexplored, and often throw us unexplained curveballs that to this day remain unexplained, offering the possibility that the more we learn about the other oceans of the solar system, the more mysterious they too will become. Science doesn't just uncover facts, but it also reveals new mysteries as well. One aspect of this is sound. Sound travels well in water, so places like Europa would be worlds of sound, unlike the surface of the moon where there is none. On Earth, since sound travels so efficiently and at such long distances in water, we can use hydrophone networks to do all sorts of listening. Often this is for military purposes, but it can also be used to study things like underwater volcanoes and the movements of whales. And that's led to some oceanic mysteries over the years, sounds that were picked up but never satisfactorily explained. And sometimes they even repeat. One example is a sound called upsweep that's picked up by the NOAA's hydrophone network, first heard in 1991. As its name would indicate, it's a sound that upsweeps, that lasts for several seconds, and then repeats. Whatever the source of this sound is, it appears to be seasonal, and it's very powerful and can be picked up throughout the Pacific Ocean. The phenomenon still occurs, but it's much weaker these days. The usual suspects here would be volcanic activity, but that's not seasonal. So whatever this sound is, it remains a mystery. On the agenda for the exploration of Europa and Enceladus' oceans is the inclusion of hydrophones to listen to the oceans of those worlds, in much the same way that we do with Earth's oceans. Sonar is also an option here to see in the otherwise complete darkness of those locked-in environments. This allows for many strange possibilities at these moons. The first is bioluminescence. In the darkness of our own oceans, life can make its own light, as well as do without it completely. Eyeless fish and glowing jellies are found here, and something like them may well be found at Europa as well, if complex life does indeed exist there. We don't yet know if it does or does not, or if ice shell moons are solely the abode of microbes, but nothing we've thought of yet stops the possibility of complex life. But the hydrophones of Europa are overwhelmingly likely to hear sounds we can't readily explain with our currently rather sparse knowledge of that moon, and we are likely to hear completely different classes of sounds. Another mystery sound from Earth's oceans, also picked up by the NOAA, is known as the whistle. And again, it sounded like a kind of whistle. This is not an unusual sound to hear in the oceans, however. Volcanic activity produces very similar sounds. The problem is the whistle only happened once in 1997 and was picked up only by a single hydrophone. Volcanic sounds tend to be picked up by multiple hydrophones. All that is known is that somewhere in the Pacific, something made a whistling sound, and only one hydrophone heard it. And since you need multiple hydrophones to triangulate a position, and it never happened again, it seems likely that we'll never know what that was. And then there are the sounds of biology. The record for the loudest known animal on Earth is not a land creature, like an elephant or a bird, it's the blue whale, and that's not the only record it holds. It's also currently the largest animal on Earth, though I stress animal since some fungus networks can be far larger. But those can't get up and hunt down a cucumber for lunch. A blue whale can hunt, it's mobile, it can swim enormous distances. But there's one more mind-blowing aspect to the blue whale. The blue whale is also the largest animal to have ever lived that we know of. It's strange to think that a living mammal can dwarf any dinosaur we've ever found, but it's true. And predictably, we hear whale song in the ocean often. Perhaps Europa will have an analog of something very loud, like the blue whale. But sometimes signals in the ocean that seem of biological origin have been picked up, but we can't tell what animal made them. And sometimes, they don't repeat. In 1997, a sound known as the bloop was picked up. This sound was heard several times, and seems to be coming from somewhere in the Pacific west of the very tip of South America. This was a weird one, in that it looked like the sound of an animal, but it was significantly louder than even a blue whale. In the end, though, the sound was thought to probably be related to an iceberg scraping the ocean floor, but if so, should have been located closer to the Antarctic coast, or near South Georgia Island, so it remains somewhat of a mystery. And while current models of Europa and Enceladus don't really allow for the ice above to scrape the ocean floor, this does bring up the overall phenomenon of cryogenic sounds, where icebergs make noises in the water. Ice can make all sorts of sounds, ranging from cracks to screams, and this may be happening with Europa and Enceladus's ice. We know that both of these worlds show evidence of cracking and movement on their surfaces, and we also know that both moons have jets of material spraying out of them that originated in the ocean below, suggesting that the ice is fully interactive with the ocean below. So, with a Europa hydrophone, we may hear plenty of ice movement going on. And then there is the geology of Europa's ocean floor. Europa is being flexed by the extreme power of Jupiter's gravity. As a result, that flexing process is what provides part of the geothermal heat for the liquid ocean. That could produce earthquakes that may make sounds, and also vents like Earth's black smokers that might provide a central hub for life on Europa's ocean floor. But within this subject, there is somewhat of a puzzling question. When you look at the cracks in the ice on Enceladus where material from below has presumably welled up, the ice is distinctly blue. On Europa, the color is distinctly brown. It's uncertain why this is, but it's as if something at Europa could be causing the discoloration that isn't occurring at Enceladus. It's worth noting here that Enceladus was a surprise in that it had an ocean at all, since that ocean would be much more dependent on radioactive decay in its core to produce the needed heat in comparison to Europa. And while the age of Enceladus has been debated, there is some indication that the ocean is only about 1 billion years old. That's plenty of time for life to arise. So it could well be there, but Europa's ocean could be far older, going back to the early days of the solar system. And Enceladus's ocean may not completely encircle the whole planet, but be localized to the southern regions, whereas Europa may be fully ocean globally. But there is one other noteworthy difference between the two moons. Europa is constantly being sneezed on by its wildly volcanic neighbor Io. You can actually see the accumulation of sulfur compounds on Europa's surface from this sneezing process, and it has presumably been going on for billions of years, so there could be a lot of sulfur compounds making their way into the ocean below. But another option is that the darkened cracks could be the result of microbial life suspended in the ice that would originally have been water welling up from below. This brings up another strange phenomenon present here on Earth. We actually have environments like those of Enceladus and Europa, but maybe even more isolated. Antarctica has subglacial lakes that have been covered in very thick ice for a very long time. The largest of these lakes is Lake Vostok, which is believed to have been isolated for something between 15 and 25 million years, at least until 2012 when Russian scientists drilled into it and started taking samples. We have no idea what life is in this lake, and it's still very poorly understood. This is a bizarre environment for Earth, in that the Vostok station above the lake has recorded the coldest temperature ever measured on Earth, negative 89 Celsius, minus 128 Fahrenheit. Yet deep below it, the conditions allow for the existence of a large liquid water lake. So we have a kind of example of an ice shell moon here on Earth. Think geothermal heating warming the lake beneath, and the ice above acting as insulation. Microbes have been found in this lake and frozen in the ice above it. Interestingly, so far, they are species that are still around up here on the surface, even after so much isolation. So biology is active down there, but how extensive is that biology? This is still unclear, but they did find DNA 97% similar to a rock cod, which is common in coastal Antarctic waters. Rock cod have an adaptation that essentially allows their bodies to produce a kind of antifreeze and survive in very cold temperatures, but 97% is somewhat of a distance genetically. We are 96% genetically similar to a gorilla, so whatever may be living down there might look very different from a rock cod. It has been suggested somewhat strongly that this might have been contamination and that the sample was a false positive, and maybe all of the samples taken thus far are false positives. But it's interesting to think about, since if a species of cod can survive down there being that isolated for at least 15 million years, then what else is down there? Thanks for listening. I am futurist and science fiction author John Michael Godier, currently worried about the Lake Vostok giant fish monster that we are currently blissfully unaware of that we've recently just disturbed with our boreholes. The cod monster may be asking itself as we speak if humans are good eating, in the ultimate case of irony. If a line and hook baited with a donut flies up out of the borehole, I advise the scientists to steer clear of it no matter how tempting that donut is. Even if it's the world's most enticing, gorgeous donut, don't do it. Kentucky Fried science fiction author eaten by an escaped Antarctic Lake Godzilla is not in my retirement planning. But my books are, so check out my books at your favorite online book retailer and subscribe to my channels for regular in-depth explorations into the interesting, weird, and unknown aspects of this amazing universe in which we live.